Good morning, and welcome to worship with the First Presbyterian Church of Vancouver. It is so wonderful to see so many of you this morning, and we know many of you are worshiping from home as well. It is great to be with you to bring glory to God. We have a number of things to highlight in the life of our congregation together. First, today is we are welcoming our choir back to worship in the sanctuary, which is great. We have a new setup, and you'll see that a little later, but it's great to have some extra voices to carry our music. So thank you to all of our choir members who have returned. I'm excited about this. Also, our mission ministry team would like to highlight for you that Give More 24 is happening later this week on Thursday, September 23rd. We have a number of ministries that we support that rely on the funds that are raised through that to support them throughout the year. So we encourage you to visit that website and check it out and to provide support to our mission partners there as well. They do some great work in our community, and we are glad to support them in this and in other ways as well. There's more information on how to do that in the bulletin as well. Later this week, we're back into the fall, and many things are ramping back up again. Our Lectio Divina Bible study continues on Wednesday at 9:30 a.m., and we have open sanctuary. You can come and worship in our space Wednesday from 11 to 1. And I'm really excited that our feast programming is returning this week. We're gearing that back up for the fall. And this week, Karen Bass is actually here to tell us a little bit more about the speaker who will be joining us this week. So Karen, come on up.
Thanks, Margaret. The speaker this week for Feast, as you probably noticed if you've looked in your bulletin, is from the National Alliance on Mental Illness. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about why this organization is so important to Greg and I. About 16 years ago, I got a phone call from the counselor at the junior high school where all of our sons had attended. One of our sons was sitting in her office. He was bleeding from several self-inflicted gashes in his arm. He was very depressed, she told me, and I needed to come get him. So I went and picked him up. We headed off to the doctor's office and stepped as a family into the world of mental illness. The day of his first hospitalization for his mental illness, I noticed a flyer for the National Alliance on Mental Illness, NAMI, with a number to call for more information on education and support groups. Well, I had recently read about NAMI in the newspaper. They'd run this big features article about a guy who I knew who had a schizophrenic son who had tried to burn his parents' house down. Well, his name and his phone number were actually the ones on that flyer. Well, I knew my kid was crazy, but I didn't think he was that crazy. So we didn't call that number. We figured we can deal with this ourselves. 3 years later, we hadn't seen any progress. In fact, things were worse, and Greg and I were really at the end of our rope. And we saw an ad in the paper, again from NAMI, for their family-to-family classes. We decided, you know, maybe we should give them a try. Well, we discovered how much we did not know, and how much help this organization could be. From those classes, we went ahead and joined a weekly support group. Eventually, Greg and I both served on the board of the Eastern Idaho chapter of the National Alliance on Mental Illness. What we learned? Well, we learned that mental illness is not rare, and it's nothing to be ashamed of. Here are some statistics. 1 in 5 adults in the U.S. experiences mental illness every year. 50% of all lifetime mental illness begins by the age of 14, 75% by the age of 24. More children in this country have a psychiatric disorder than have cancer, diabetes, and AIDS combined. It is very likely that mental illness, whether your own or that of a family member, has affected nearly everyone in this congregation. Greg and I and the newly formed First Presbyterian Church Mental Health Support Team would like to invite all of you to join us on Wednesday for this year's first feast presentation, Bridges to Hope, that will be given by Deanna Lugo from the NAMI Southwest Washington affiliate. There is hope. There is help. Please join us.
Thanks, Karen. I know we have a team that's working on supporting mental health here in our own congregation, and I'm really excited about that. I didn't realize the statistics are quite what they were, but 1 in 5. So I know that that affects many of us here, and certainly you know somebody. So I encourage you to join us this Wednesday to hear more about NAMI Southwest Washington and how we as a congregation can be more supportive of people in our midst that are wrestling with that. Today, we are continuing in our Why We Worship the Way We Do series, and we are continuing to advance our deeper engagement for children here in worship. So a little later, you'll be hearing about the worship project we have today. But as you may have noticed on the way in, today is our Singing Praise Sunday, so we'll be talking and expressing that. So on your way in, you may have noticed that we have some instruments. There's some, or some. So I encourage you, if you didn't pick one up, there's some instruments on the way in. Hopefully Ed won't be annoyed too much by all of our joyful additions to the music today. But yes, we are singing praise, and there are many ways to do that and ways to enhance that. So we have some instruments that we can all participate here in worship. If you're worshiping from home, find something, some spoons out of the kitchen drawer, something to tap on as we continue lifting our voices and joining in song and in praise to God. So with that, let us gather our joy and our attention to worship God this morning.
If you have an instrument, you could play. Whenever I play the drum, you can play along on this. The choir is going to sing Psalm 98, All the Ends of the Earth, which I was looking at the words thinking, boy, this really, really fits the rainstorm. If you stayed awake all night listening to the rain and rejoicing, God has done wonderful things. The power of God comes in the love for the earth. Let's stand, choir. Take it away, Lori.
To the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Lord, a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. All of the ends of earth have seen salvation by our God. Joyfully sing out, all you lands. Break forth in song. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord. the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord with harp and song, with trumpet and with horn. Sing in your joy before the King, the King our Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds. Sing to the Lord a new song, for God has done wonderful deeds.
So with our worship activities over this course, last week we celebrated, we learned more about the call to worship, and as part of our activity, we invited people to write and share some call to worships. So in the coming weeks, we are going to be using some of those as we call one another to worship this morning, and today's was submitted by Joyce Russell, and it has some hand motions, so I'm going to show it, and then we will practice once together. And then we will officially do it together. So the first is, O come, and then you make a come motion. Let us worship, you make a W with your arms. Come, let us worship and bow down, we bow. Let us kneel before the Lord, you make an L. Our maker, make a fist with an M, just the three of your fingers making an M. So before the Lord, our maker, for the Lord is our God. So you point to God with your hand over your heart. Lord is our God. And we are the people of his pasture. So like you're walking along a pasture, people of his pasture. And the sheep, so you hold your fist like that, and then you pet it, like you're petting a sheep. The sheep of his hand, you show your hands. All right, I say you're doing it again. Let's practice one more time together. So, O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For the Lord is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. All right. Let us do it together, and you can say the words aloud with me. If you don't have to kneel if you don't want to. I know some people have a harder time getting up and down, but I invite you to stand at least for the rest of it as you are able. All right, let's do it together. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For the Lord is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Amen. Thank you.
Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is our help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near, join me in glad the Lord who bore all things so wondrously reigneth, shelters thee under his wings, yea, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desires e'er have been granted in what he ordained? Praise ye the Lord, oh, let all that is in me abide. adore him. All that have life and breath, come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people.
The Apostle Paul writes, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but are justified, are declared forgiven freely through Jesus Christ." Confident that God is ever ready to forgive, let us confess our sin, first in unison and then in silence. Let us pray together. Holy Spirit, as the wind is your symbol, so forward our goings. As the dove, so purify our spirits. As a cloud, so abate our temptations. As dew, so revive our languor. As fire, so purge out our dross. And here now, we humbly ask our silent prayers of confession. Create in us clean hearts, O Lord, and renew right spirits within us. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ lived for us. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Friends in Christ, we are forgiven. The peace of Christ be with you. Let's take a moment to pass the peace of Christ and other greetings to our neighbors from a distance.
This joy I have, the world did give to me. This joy I have, the world did give to me. Joy I have, the world did give to me. The world did give it and the world can't take it away. This world I have, the world did give it to me. This love I have did give it to me. This love I have, the world did give it to me. The world did give it and the world can't take it away. This hope I have, the world did give it to me. This hope I have, the world did give it to me. This hope I have, the world did give it to me. The world did give it and the world can't take it away. Faith, this faith I have, this faith, the world. No, it didn't give to me. This faith, the world didn't give it to me. This faith, this faith, this faith, the world didn't give it to me. The world didn't give it and the world can't take it away. This peace I have, the world did give it to me. This peace I have, the world did give it to me. the world can't take it away.
Well, good morning, disciples, young and old. Do you like music? Have you ever had your parents tell you, turn that music down? Or ask you, what's that racket you're listening to? I'm sure you have, and I did too. There's lots of styles of music. We've got gospel and pop, folk, jazz, hip-hop, country, classical, easy listening, and many more. But just imagine your favorite TV show or a movie with words only, no music, no instruments or vocal in the background. It'd make what we listen to now pretty boring without that music. Music brings out the feelings in us. So it makes us happy and anxious, sad or excited and relaxed. Music is an art form consisting of sequences of sound and time and tones of definite pitch that are organized melodically and harmonically and according to their tone color. But what type of musical instruments do you think Jesus listened to? I mean, electric guitars and keyboards and amps weren't around 2,000 years ago. I don't know what they did. Well, they had instruments very similar to the ones that we use today. They had drums, and they had cymbals, tambourines, harps and lyres, and trumpets made from ram's horns. In today's scripture, Psalm 150 is all about music. The word psalm means songs of praise. So listen for the references to music as I read it. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and the harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and lutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. The book of Psalms is actually 150 songs written for use in the Jewish temple, and many of them have been made into songs that we use today in worship. In Ephesians 5:18 and 19 says, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with songs of praise, hymns and songs from the Spirit, songs and music, songs sing and make music from the heart to the Lord. And in Psalm 95, it says again, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout to the Lord, the rock of our salvation. And when we worship through music, we'll be renewed and transformed. When we sing and offer ourselves to God, something godly will happen in our lives. Music strengthens us, builds us, and restores us. And praise songs aren't just for worship services. They're for wherever you may be. Music helps to restore you, helps you study, prepare for a test, get focused for a game or a performance. So sing wherever you are, in your car, when you're hiking, when you're walking to school. Sing to your pet. Sometimes they might even sing back, which could be good or bad. We have a wide variety of great music right here in our own church. Ed and Lori select a variety of songs and instruments to make our worship experience pleasing. We have our vocal choir, and we have guitarists, the bell choir, bagpipes, Jim Fisher and his friends, and their special music on certain Sundays. But you know, our scripture talks about cymbals twice, so it must be important, and yet we don't have a cymbal choir. So maybe we can get Pastor Margaret and Sarah Colmer to help you form a cymbal choir from our youth and preschool. Don't know if that'll pass with Josh and Ed. Now, Michelle Sylvie has a little bit to tell you about the handout and our little gift packs here today.
Good morning. I'm usually in John's position, so this is kind of amusing to me. I represent the children's ministry team, and I think the youngest person here today is my own son. And so I'm certain he's not going to want to come up and take the activity. But our ministry has opted to play it safe and to not use our Sunday school rooms and to still engage the children in what our children have grown up with here. And that's a multi-age, multi-generational love of the Lord. And the activity packs that we're designing will be correlated with whatever Josh or Margaret are presenting. And we'll go forward with different projects that are hands-on. When my kiddos were little, and I saw Therese out there, she can attest to this, the only thing for children in worship was the little sheet of paper with a teddy bear on it. And my kids wrote us, scribbled, and those became my Bible bookmarks. So there's plenty of ways to entertain ourselves, but this is a heightened way. And so for kiddos at home today, and those of you who want to come make a little tambourine, it's more a thinking idea. So I challenge you with serve the Lord with gladness, come before him with joyful songs. And the idea today would be to think in what ways do we already do this here at First Pres, at church, at home, and in nature. And the kit would say you could write, so it's two plates put together with the option of writing a song we already know, such as Jesus Loves Me, or another favorite, the B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me, very kid-friendly. You can do patterns like the piano. If you were sitting in the pew, it would give you an idea of what do we call the people that are singing? And you could draw them on here. We call them the choir, and we met them again today. We also had instruments, so in the kit were some bells. So at home, figure out ways in which you could be interactive. This would have called you to look forward to the hymn in your pew. Where are the songs located in the Bible in front of you? And that would be the Psalms. So we hope to carry this on. These will remain in the children's young disciple zone at the entry. And for preschoolers or anyone who come in, they can grab a kit. Those of you young at heart can continue to be creative and put up with the kids. We're going to teach them to be respectful in the pew, but definitely not silent or still. So go in peace and love the Lord. Make a joyful noise. Amen.
Thank you, John and Michelle. And judging from the jingle jangle of the instruments out there, we do have a lot of young at heart people present this morning. As we prepare to hear the good news, let us pray. Holy Spirit, blow on us like the wind. Fall on us like the rain. Shine on us like the sun. Give us ears to hear, hearts to embrace, and minds to understand your word. Through Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, we pray. Amen. Over the past 8+ years, we have occasionally had dialogue sermons in which I have interviewed various members of the congregation. Previously, I've interviewed our youth, our retired clergy, and a panel with representatives from 5 different generations in our church. Raise your hand if you've been part of a dialogue sermon in the past. A few hands up out there. This morning, we're continuing our Why We Worship the Way We Do sermon series with a consideration of sacred music and congregational singing, big parts of our corporate worship services. Given this focus, it seemed appropriate to me to pick the brain of our longtime music director, Ed Bodie. After I read this morning's passage of scripture, I'll be asking Ed a number of questions. Our text, as you just heard in the message for young disciples, is Psalm 150, a song that was part of ancient Israel's hymn book. The psalmist sings, "Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise God for his mighty deeds. Praise God according to his surpassing greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise God with tambourine and dance. Praise God with strings and pipe. Praise God with clanging cymbals. Praise God with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that breathes praise the Lord." Praise the Lord. Ed, easy question to start. How long have you been a music director in various churches?
I started working in churches in 72, playing French horn in places like Crystal Cathedral and places like that down in Southern California.
Robert Schuller's Crystal Cathedral. Wow.
But I started directing a choir without having a clue what I was doing in 1976. I was a French horn player, but I saw the ad in a paper and I thought, well, my dad can do it. So I figured I could, and I applied. And so it's, I guess I have about 43, 44 years of church choir directing experience.
Wow. So part of what we're trying to do with this sermon series is to learn about the distinctives of our particular Reformed and Presbyterian tradition in worship. And our Reformed tradition has called hymns and sacred songs sung prayers. What do you see as the value of singing our prayers to God? Why not just use spoken words in our worship?
Well, I used to hear people say a lot that singing is praying twice. And I always wonder, what the heck does that mean? But I have a new grandbaby, and it reminded me of all my new babies. At times, I had five of them. And when they're born, they don't really have an emotional body yet. It just starts that very first moment with you. And Jesus said, when you pray, think of God as Abba, which in those days meant daddy. It meant that close, loving relationship, which to me means the very depth of our emotional being. The one that started when we're babies. And our moms and dads or whoever takes care of us are the ones that help nurture that emotional person. So I think when we pray, that's a good place to return to is thinking about God in terms of that kind of love. When we play music, scratches those emotions. It gets in there, and every once in a while, it just comes right out, and it's all kind of the same thing. I think maybe that's what they mean, that praying and singing are kind of the same thing. It's because you do it from the same part of your being that you pray to God with in the most intimate way. And you can hear the difference when the choir sings and their hearts are invested, or when they're just struggling to sing the notes. I always try to get them to move away from the notes and listen, it's really something else. I'm not always successful, but that's my theory.
Mm-hmm. So when you sing, you pray twice. Was that the expression?
Yeah.
I like that. I had not heard that before. I like it. Another part of our Reformed tradition, and this might surprise people, has been psalm singing. In fact, John Calvin and later the Puritans believed that only psalms should be sung in worship. Now, obviously, we sing more than just psalms. Imagine, Ed, that the folks out there are Puritans. And I know that's hard. That's hard to do. and make your case for a variety of music and songs in worship.
Well, I respect John Calvin and all those folks, but how many people here believe in the Holy Spirit? That's perfect. I believe the Holy Spirit said, that's enough of this nonsense, Reformation. And at first, John Calvin and all those folks, they said, okay, we're not going to have somebody telling us everything to do. We're going to do it ourselves. But then I think they were insecure a little bit about being on their own without rules, and they kind of went overboard. And the truth is that the Psalms are in a nice poetic kind of a setup, and it worked well. So any music that would appear, okay, we'll just do it with the Psalms. That way we're not going to have evil coming into our worship service. We're just going to stick with the Bible. So that meant you couldn't sing Holy Night on Christmas. You couldn't have Jim Fisher on All Saints Day. That meant for them, I don't believe they had the organ or instruments.
Right.
And certainly there was no Christ the Lord is risen. It's not biblical. It's not biblical text. Mm-hmm. So basically what you had was the Taliban. they weren't out cutting heads off, but the Taliban, they're very strict about what can be happen musically, just kind of like that, mm-hmm. because of fear. But the Holy Spirit keeps going, and Reformation was just the begin. And so what happens is either we're all going to try to make ourselves to be the same person, or we're going to celebrate the individuality that God gives us. And I figured that out, you know, in that snowflake thing back in science when you couldn't find one that matched. People are just like that. And each person has their own revelation and their own love and potential experience in music. And so we have a world of variety now. And I think that the Holy Spirit is trying to get affirmation of the individual who is loving and considerate.
Mm-hmm. So we can't contain the Holy Spirit's music making.
Yes.
And limit it. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I certainly agree with you that the Reformers overcorrected in some ways. And I think this is a good example of Calvin overcorrecting in reaction to
freedom,
the Roman Catholic Church at that time. Yeah. Now, I should also add that Martin Luther, was not in agreement with Calvin, and Luther, of course, was known for writing his own hymns in pubs while drinking beer. Mighty Fortress Is Our God, for example. So we can kind of pick and choose our reformer based on what we prefer on a given topic, right? Ed, something that might not be well known, and I want it to be well known, is the fact that the vast majority of the music played and sung in our worship services is chosen by you. Occasionally, I will request a particular hymn or song, but more often I simply give you a text, the biblical text that I'm preaching on, and some general thoughts, the direction I'm planning to go with it, and then you make the musical selections. So how do you choose your pieces? Describe your process.
Well, I can describe the process. It's kind of one that's evolved. The truth is that between Lori and I, if you add up the years of church experience, we have over 80 years of professional working experience. That's a lot. And so she has a great background, and I have a background, and the truth is that we sit down and plan it together. And we've done it in different ways, but we have a ritual that we gather together on Thursday night, go to Super Taco. get our dinner, and go home, eat, and get the literature out. And what we do is at this point, I mean, there has been times when some of the things that Josh has preached on, I have had to go into a religious trance to be able to figure out what to sing. It really took divine inspiration because there was no study material for it. But what Lori and I do is we read, study, and reflect on the text for any given Sunday. We research any available written study aids and hymn suggestions that are available for that weekly text. Individually, we select a list of potential hymns, and then we put them all together. And the kinds of things that we think about are, can the people sing them? Do they know them? Lori's biggest input is she wants to make sure that I don't plan for her to play the organ on songs that aren't organ quality. Because I'm a light my fire organ guy, and I don't really, you know, have the background she has in the pipe organ. She keeps us pure in that way. We go by if we have the choir, and really the singability of the hymns. I have sometimes get requests from people to do hymns that the theme is absolutely opposite of what Josh has got going for the service. Josh really does have a overall theme for a service, and we try to spend quite a bit of time just trying to find music that enhances that and supports that.
Mm-hmm. Which I appreciate. Yeah, and I also want to just a shout out to Lori, who we also appreciate, and we're very aware that the two of you are a music team, and Lori, we love you too. So two things I heard in there that I did not know. The music that we sing on Sunday morning, that is partly due to Super Taco. Is that in there?
Yes.
Okay.
Every Thursday.
All right, last question. Thinking about our congregational singing, what would you like to see or hear more of? What advice would you give to people who are reticent to sing?
Well, I'm going to read something I wrote for you today. From the fall of 1979 until the end of the school year in 1988, I made the lion's share of my income as a school bus driver. One beautiful sunny day in April, after a long season of rain, I was called for substitute kindergarten driving, which I didn't usually do, to take the young ones home at their usual midday end of their school day. About 30 polite and quiet children came onto the bus, and they were very surprised to see someone they didn't recognize about to take them out onto the road. Once they realized I was a very safe and careful driver, they began to relax and enjoy the beautiful spring day. Well, something happened that day. It started with one child making odd little noises. I listened and drove on. But then another joined in, and they were cantering back and forth. And then another joined in. They were making little children noises with no adult words, just tones, slides, chimes, and nonsense words. And then fairly quickly, they all were doing it. I assume they were all doing their own version of the Songbirds of Spring. I have yet to this day have ever heard such beautiful music as coming out of the voices of those little children. Okay, fast forward. Sometime this past late July this year, when many of us are watching the Olympics, an American team was being presented with a gold medal and the Star Spangled Banner was being played. The athletes were all respectful, none of it getting down on a knee thing, no problem. But not one of them sang. A couple of days ago, I was remembering when I knew my young boy voice back in the third grade. I could sing the roof off at the church. My Sunday school teacher said I should audition for school choir the next year. But in the fourth grade, I had some weird hormone things happening, and my voice started changing in the fourth grade. And when the choir teacher held auditions, I showed up and was asked to sing the national anthem. Well, I didn't read music. My voice was cracking between registers, and I had no chance of being invited to sing in the choir. I was humiliated, and I never sang again until I was a senior in high school because I was so embarrassed of my voice. I was so shocked and so pleased to find my voice again. But now I'm wondering about the national anthem. This song is very difficult to sing well. I'm wondering how many Americans were embarrassed as youth because they couldn't sing this very difficult song in unison with their classmates. How many of us are publicly shamed as youth, struggling to find our voice? How many of us never get over our embarrassment over how our voices sound and what we cannot do with them? I wonder how many of those sweet singing kindergartners that spring day are still singing today. I hope all of them. Well, the truth is, most humans are folk singers with limited vocal range, and they're not choral singers. Most choral singers are not opera singers. If you cannot sing the national anthem, you are way in the majority of the people. Personally, I think it's stupid to have a national anthem that less than 1% of the population can sing well. But church is a place you can safely find that sweet voice of your childhood. That's where I found mine. Nobody will forbid your singing. Most of our hymns are folk songs in disguise, written for folk singers. And the ones that aren't, let the choir do it.
Ed, we appreciate you. We appreciate your many years of service to the church and for your ongoing music leadership. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Let everything that breathes praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen. So we're going to join our voices together, not quite yet again in song, but in the spoken word of our affirmation of faith. So I invite you to rise as you are able, and in body or in spirit, as we say these words of our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
My life flows on in endless awe, a mother's lamentation. Christ is Lord of heaven and earth. How can I keep sword can shake my inmost call. What to that rock I'm clinging, since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? What though my joys and comforts die, the Lord my Savior liveth. What though the darkness gathered round, songs in the night it giveth. Storm can shake my inmost call, but to that rock I'm clinging, since Christ is Lord of heaven. How can I keep from singing? The peace of Christ makes fresh my heart, a fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am His. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my soul, but to that rock I'm clinging, since Christ is Lord of heaven.
Speaking of folk songs, amen. You may be seated. We now have a moment for mission, and this is going to be given by Carol Doan. And I do want to apologize to Carol for a typo in the bulletin. It is Woman of Wonder is the organization that Carol founded and is going to tell us more about, not Women of Wonder. And I believe she's going to explain why that is an important difference. Carol.
Thank you. I'm Carol Doan. I founded Woman of Wonder, a nonprofit 501c3 that provides college scholarships for women. And the reason why we're Woman of Wonder is because I want a woman who receives one of our scholarships to have the confidence to get up and say, I am a woman of wonder. As I raised my daughter, I stressed going to college. It felt like mom insurance. You know, it was insurance that she would have a better paying job, a chance at that. Insurance that she'd be protected through the ups and downs of the economy. And what we're finding right now is that college degrees are protecting people's jobs during the pandemic. And I also wanted her to have a chance to explore and have a career that she loves. As women, a lot of people have jobs they like, but they don't love. And education gives us that opportunity to find that right career. I come from a family who values education and actually like talking to people in education. And during a conversation I had a few years back with the marketing director at Washington State University here in Vancouver, I heard that sometimes the thing that keeps somebody from showing up that first day of class, they have everything organized, but the thing that's missing is as little as $200. And in that moment I thought, oh my gosh, I'd pay $200 to help somebody get to their first day of class. And so that planted a seed among many others that led to founding Woman of Wonder. As women go through life, they take on more responsibilities. And sometimes our choices get smaller. The choice to go for a college degree, to work on a college degree, or even finish a degree get very, very narrow. And what Woman of Wonder is trying to do is to fill those gaps in a woman's life and be that thing that encourages and supports them to finish their degree, go for a better paying career that will help them sustain their family. I'm really excited to share with you that this is the first year that we're going to be participating in Give More 24. That's a 24-hour giving period here in Clark County, where you have the choice of about 200 different nonprofits to give to on that day. And with a name like Woman of Wonder, we're gonna be at the bottom of that list. So I hope as you plan your giving, you'll go to the bottom of the list and then start going up until you find us. Because the second thing that I'm really excited to share is that we have matching funds so that your small gift can become a medium gift, your medium gift becomes a large gift, and your large gift is thrilling. I'd like to thank the church and the missions ministry for supporting us. It means a lot. And I'd like you to consider supporting us as well. I'd like you to think about a woman in your life who sustained you, who supported you with love, with a meal, and with encouragement. And I'd like you to take that gift that you received and pay it forward and provide support and encouragement to a woman that's trying to pursue a college degree. Thank you.
And we are thankful for you, Carol, and for Woman of Wonder. Woke up yesterday to the news that 99% of our ICU beds in Clark County are full. Sobering news to start the weekend, and seemed appropriate to me to return to an intercession for healing that we used earlier in the pandemic and pray that as our prayers of the people this morning. It is responsive, so when you hear me pray, Lord, in your mercy, I invite you to respond, hear our prayer. Let's try that. Lord, in your mercy. And there will also be a number of pauses in the prayer, and during that time, I invite you to lift names of people who are either ill or people who are in healthcare and caring for the sick. Lift those names to the Lord in the silence. Let us pray. God, our Creator, your will for us and for all your people is wholeness and salvation. Have mercy on us. Jesus Christ, Son of God, you came that we might have life and have it in abundance. Have mercy on us. Holy Spirit, dwelling within us, you make us temples of your presence. Have mercy on us. To the triune God, the source of all love and life, we offer our prayers. For all who are in need of healing, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. For all who are disabled by injury or illness, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. For all who are troubled by confusion or burdened by pain, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. For all whose increasing years bring weariness, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. For all about to undergo surgery, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. For all who cannot sleep, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. For all who practice the healing arts, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. And to these prayers, we add the prayer Jesus has taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. The author of Hebrews writes, "Through him, then, let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of lips that confess his name. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God." Let us give generously of all that we have, whether it be our material resources, our time, energy, or attention, as an expression of our gratitude for all that God has done, as an outpouring of joy for the benefit of others. Let us pray. God, you are the God of life and life abundant. We are grateful for the many blessings that you have entrusted to our care, and we want to be people of joy and generosity. As we return a portion of those gifts to you, may you use them and transform us to express your love and care for the world. Amen.
Drive the gloom of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works rejoice around the earth, and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around the center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, all us to rejoice in thee. Join the happy chorus which the morning stars began. Love divine is reigning o'er us, joining all in heaven's plan. Ever singing march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us on in the triumph song of life.
Now may the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the songs of the Spirit bless you and keep you now and forevermore. Amen.